confronted with a nearly limitless universe, billions of years old, with an almost infinitely vast number of opportunities for life to develop, the Italian physicist Enrico Fermi, while sitting for lunch at Los Alamos with some of his colleagues in 1950, asked this question that still perplexes us as we look up into the night sky. Where is everybody? Good evening, guys. Tonight we're going to talk about Enrico Fermi, the Fermi paradox. It's one of my personal favorites in the science fiction, maybe futurism genre. And it's this brilliant physicist who came up with the idea that it's kind of paradoxical that the universe seems blooming with stars and what we can only assume is accompanying planets in the respective solar systems of the literally trillions of observable stars in our universe. So he wanted to know what could the possible reasons for the fact that we haven't detected alien life be, and we're gonna discuss some of these tonight. So find a comfortable spot, put some headphones in, let's relax, and let's find out about this this paradox. The Fermi paradox, which assumes that we should definitely have detected intelligent life by now, remains an all-time most bedeviling lunchtime remark, and it relies on four fairly short assumptions. One, there's nothing special about our sun. It's ordinary, relatively young, and there are billions of stars in our galaxy that are much older. Begs the question. Two, there must be planets like ours revolving around those stars. In fact, scientists now believe there are billions of exoplanets in the Milky Way alone. Exoplanets being any planets outside our anthropocentric solar system. Because intelligent life developed on Earth, and there are billions of Earth-like planets, we have every reason to believe that, of course, intelligent life could develop on those other planets as well. Three. After millions of years of technological progress, millions, an alien civilization would likely have the technology to travel to other stars and even galaxies. In less than 100 years, after all, man has gone from flying for a world record of only about 20 seconds at Kitty Hawk in North Carolina with the Wright brothers, to walking on the moon over 200,000 miles away. And well, I guess you could even say that was barely 60 years. probably only about 50 years if you count orbiting the moon. So in the time span of millions of years, 50 years is quite inconsequential. And yeah, it just really hammers the point home. In number four, to elaborate on the possibilities of an advanced civilization and their behavior, given a few more million years, an alien civilization could most likely populate an entire galaxy. So how exactly would an alien civilization colonize a galaxy? So this is going to elaborate a little bit, fuse ideas with the Kardashev video. We all know, if you've seen that video, most likely you have, because it was one of my more popular videos. So, if you haven't, briefly, Kardashev was a famous Soviet Russian astronomer, Nikolai Kardashev, and he developed a scale that... it's a hypothetical classification system for alien civilizations based on their energy consumption. And the physicist Michio Kaku, famed guy, he's on TV a lot nowadays, one of the top five famous physicists, I would say he's up there, he elaborated on it and defined it more precisely, or more generally, as three different types. Well, technically four, if you count us as a sub type one. So we're something currently less than a type one, but type one would be a civilization that could harness the energy of an entire planet. That means wind, solar, volcanic, plate tectonic energy, and tap, harvest, all of the solar radiation that hits the planet for our energy consumption. And this civilization could most likely control the weather, so they would have a very firm grasp on their home planet. So type two is scaling up by roughly an order of magnitude. A civilization could harness the energy output of an entire star and generates about 10 billion times, oh sorry, I was way off. 10 billion times the energy output of a type 1. So they're accelerating. They're increasing by a factor of 10 billion. I don't know why I thought it was an order of magnitude, which would be a billion times less. But it's a type 2 civilization, so they would be able to, the famous Dyson Sphere, if you've never heard of that, it's an idea conceived by Freeman Dyson, a famous physicist, that this type of civilization would potentially be able to build, which is a structure that would essentially encompass an entire star and could absorb all the energy output of an entire star. And while it could be more of like a bee swarm, so made up of, you know, trillions of individual objects, material machines that create some sort of spherical encapsulation of the star, or it could be an actual solid, unified, attached structure, spherical structure, you know, roughly encompassing the entire star. Either way, it would be incredible. So a type 3 would be 10 billion times the energy harnessing. It would have 10 billion times the energy, able to harness that much more than a type 2, which at this point would be on a galactic level, millions, even billions of stars. And that's what Fermi thought a sufficiently advanced civilization, sufficiently evolved civilization could eventually get to. So, if human technological growth continues at an average of 3% a year, Kaku posits that our own civilization may attain type 1 status in only about 200 years, type 2 in a few thousand, and type 3 in no more than a million years. So, by the time a civilization reaches type 2 and enjoys the energy of an entire star, new forms of travel, of course, become possible. And our binary concept, I mean, well, it's binary to the layman like me. It's the lines between matter and energy start to get blurred, and our concept of what matter or material reality really is, I'm sure in 1,000 years, I'm sure even in 100 years, our perspective on material reality and in accordance with that, our ability to travel through space and our concept of how to travel through space even, I'm sure by then will be radically altered, you know. So to me, it's just really, really thought-provoking, and there's so many questions. So many possibilities, I guess, is what inspires me to want to pursue and look into this stuff. According to the mathematicians Duncan Forgan and Arwen Nicholson from Edinburgh, self-replicating spacecraft traveling at 1/10 the speed of light, admittedly a quick speed, could travel the entire Milky Way. Which leads us to Fermi's paradox. Intelligent life has every chance of existing and has had plenty of time to develop beyond anything imaginable today. So why haven't we observed signs of them? Here's six. There are actually a lot more. People have taken this and ran with it. And if you're interested, I would, maybe I'll put a link, hopefully I'll remember to put a link to Isaac Arthur, his channel on science and futurism on YouTube, on here, it's just really brilliant. It's well thought out, pretty darn good editing for an amateur production. He's a physicist himself, and he has of videos on this exact topic, so if you haven't, I would suggest going to check him out. So I'm only gonna get to three of them today because I'm kind of running short on time right now, but if you guys enjoy it, just leave a comment and I'll pick up the other three, and you know, maybe more, of course, because there's so many more out there, but we're at least gonna tackle half the list today. And these are the solutions, potentially, to why we haven't been able to detect life outside of Earth, intelligent life. This first one's called the Zoo Hypothesis. Like the Federation from Star Trek, super intelligent alien life may answer to a prime directive. This is a non-interference directive that essentially urges or requires people following those orders not to interfere with civilizations on planets below a threshold of technological advancement. Now, I guess there could be many diverging theories about this. You know, at what point do they pass the threshold? It's called the Zoo Hypothesis. And this theory was formally proposed as a solution to the Fermi paradox by John Ball at Harvard, at the Harvard Smithsonian Center for Astrophysics in 1973. Given the age of the universe, Ball noted that multiple Type 3 civilizations may have actually appeared millions or even billions of years ago. With such a vast head start, these civilizations would have complete control over essentially our entire known universe. They'd be able to destroy or control less advanced life forms, just like humans have done on Earth, like we did to Neanderthals and Neanderthals and all the other extinct life forms, mammoths, saber-tooths. And these civilizations, they'd have to still grapple with the same ethical question as the Federation and Star Trek. What's the right way to interact with less advanced civilizations, some millions of years behind? On Earth, we've decided to create nature reserves and national parks. So of course you can imagine, extrapolate that into space and the galaxy. Maybe that's where we are right now. Maybe there's some sort of highly advanced force field, undetectable to us, that's filtering out any sort of communications. Or maybe there's a subspace communication type of technology that we haven't been able to understand, comprehend, or even detect at our primitive phase of technological innovation right now. So so they might be observing our progress from afar, hiding from us until they decide that we're ready to join the galactic civilization. And of course, this is also just like the idea behind 2001: A Space Odyssey, where they leave the black block for us to find in a buried deep in the moon or some other location inaccessible to us. Perhaps they're observing us closer than we think, and instead of technology, or maybe in conjunction with technology, they're waiting to see if our morals. Couldn't play that one off. I was trying to be slick. That's what I get. So, maybe they're beholding the man, as Ecce Homo means. And they're waiting to see if our morals develop to a point where we can harness our passion and not be overcome by irrationality, and maybe to the point where empathy is greater than individual gain. So maybe to the point where we can cooperate and coexist and cohabitate with each other in such a way that would reflect on our possible interaction among the galactic community as a single entity. So that's always another possibility. So number two, now, second solution to the Fermi paradox is that we're living in a simulated universe. Call them crazy, but renowned scientists, philosophers, engineers, they're developing increasingly creative, some would say delusional, ideas about how a simulated universe would actually work. And if you guys haven't seen it, I'm going to point you to, a really, really good documentary that elaborates on this concept very well, and in a really entertaining manner. Just type in the simulation hypothesis, and it should show up. Anyways, it's really brilliant. That's a whole nother episode in itself, so we'll elaborate on it a little bit here, obviously, but some of their arguments are logical, perhaps even convincing, and they've been debated by serious academics, serious journals, for a while now. Nick Bostrom, a philosopher at Oxford and director of the Future of Humanity Institute, has developed my favorite argument in a paper. Obviously, I'm reading right now, but still a good argument, from what I get, called "Are You Living in a Computer Simulation?" He argues that at least one of the following must be true. One out of three. first is humans are likely to go extinct before they are post-human and able to create entirely simulated realities, i.e. an entirely simulated universe. Two is a post-human civilization with the ability to run such a simulation would likely not run many simulations because of the immense amount of resources needed, and perhaps because of other ethical considerations about the simulation. For instance, if you did run a simulation, you would imagine that it would be running beyond quicker than real time, and if you created sentient life forms in that simulation and they were subject to torture and, well, just general suffering, there would be an ethical dilemma there to really, even if they weren't suffering, the dilemma would be, should you, in essence, delete them from existence by turning your simulation off, if they really were just ones and zeros? Which at that point, I think we'd be at the level of quantum computing, so I don't think we would actually ever, I don't think it would be as simple, as cut and dry, as binary, literally, as ones and zeros. And then the third one is that we're currently living in a computer simulation. So using extremely clever logic and a bit of mathematical fiddling, Bostrom concludes that the belief that there is a significant chance that we will one day become post-human who run ancestor simulations, similar to the one I just briefly outlined, the belief that there's a significant chance we'll do this is false, unless we are currently living in a simulation. Remember, this is a philosopher at Oxford speaking. Yeah, that's pretty wild. So, if the universe is 15 billion years old and civilizations have potentially already evolved, you know, even millions of years ago, you know, let alone the fact that we evolved over about 4 billion years, 4.5, there's a good chance that something else could have evolved billions of years ago. So the level of technology that would have manifested, been created by now, would be so advanced that if it was highly probable that they could reach and would run those simulations, it would have already happened. Now, of course, that could be counter-argued by the fact that, or the potential fact, that we are indeed the first of our kind, so to speak, the first intelligent life forms in the universe, or at least our galaxy, or at least our quadrant, local area of the galaxy so far. How would such a simulation be created? Writers have long tried to speculate that something called a Matryoshka brain might be developed by a type 2 or type 3 civilization an almost inconceivably huge computer system that runs on the entire energy output of a star. Dang. Using a Dyson sphere, it's a shell that could surround the star. Using a shell, you know, like we said earlier, that would surround the star and be able to harness pretty much all of its heat and other radiation as energy. Mathematicians have calculated that a Matryoshka brain, Matryoshka brain, could have the computational power to create a simulated universe with all of us living inside. This idea, believe it or not, does not appear to violate any laws of physics that we know about. Isaac Arthur has a really, really good video on black hole farming, which I might try to use some material to make a little video about that myself from him. This is so fascinating, and you know, he's a physicist, so he makes it that much more credible than it could happen with his ideas of his practical mathematics behind the potential construction and engineering of such a device that like a Matryoshka brain, Matryoshka, could it could be so large and so powerful that it could effectively run on for infinity for our relative perspectives inside the simulation. And so using a black hole, and you know what, I won't go into it because I forget too much of it. It's not gonna make sense. But yeah, so we'll skip that, but it's a very fascinating concept that we could potentially ultimately harvest a black hole at the center of the Milky Way, for instance, for us, if we ever lived long enough to see the universe expand so far that there were no other galaxies in sight, and the only remaining source of energy was actually from black holes. But I don't know, at that point we'll probably somehow be able to tap into the ambient energy of still space-time. So the last one I'm going to tackle today is that aliens are broadcasting, but like I mentioned earlier, we might not have the technology to even detect the form of communication that they're using. So you've all heard of the SETI Institute. The search for extraterrestrial intelligence. This is exactly what they're counting on. With a little imagination, it's easy to think of a number of reasons why we haven't been able to communicate with aliens. Aliens might not be broadcasting using radio waves. They might be using different frequencies than the one SETI is currently listening on or monitoring. They might use neutrinos or lasers, so the frequencies might be from such a powerful source that they don't radially propagate through space, but perhaps they only target a specific receiver with pinpoint precision. So there might be that form of a sort of galactic internet. Complex compression algorithms that we don't understand. Gamma ray bursts that we can't detect. Modulation methods that we haven't discovered. And the list goes on. In 1985, Carl Sagan gave with an especially compelling reason for why we're missing alien signals. He speculated that aliens may communicate at a rate so slow, or conversely so fast, that we don't even recognize their efforts. If an alien civilization takes years to broadcast a single sentence, or even a single word, we might not be able to recognize that that's what we're hearing. They may be communicating with matryoshka brains, or even more advanced technologies that we can't even imagine and may never discover. So we've been searching for signals for only less than 100 years. And, you know, if you think about just how much our technology for communicating has advanced and even radically changed from literal writing on stones to paper, which we did. You know, that took thousands of years. And then paper to electricity, that took another, you know, 1,000 years, 2,000 years or so. You know, we've only been using electricity to communicate, store, transmit data. Our methods for communicating using radio waves, it might be so antique, antiquated, obsolete at that point that, you know, that's why we're not detecting them. They might have abandoned those methods millions of years ago, or perhaps skipped them altogether. The chance that our method of communication aligns perfectly with an alien's begins to look really slim. So, alright guys, well thank you very much for joining. This is a topic that's near and dear to my heart, so I'm more than likely, well, I'm sure you guys will enjoy this too. Hopefully I made it relaxing. I'm sorry if you heard some traffic in the background. It's a bad time of day, but it's the only time I could make at the moment. So I'm trying to put out content, but I have to do it when I can. I hope you guys enjoyed it, and as always, thank you all for your love, your subscriptions, your likes, comments, and of course, feedback. So if you have any advice you'd like to give me, maybe something I'm doing different, something I could be doing different to evolve for the better, of course, I'm open. As I told Cameron last night, a Patreon of mine, who was afraid that I was not going to be too fond of constructive criticism. I'm on the side of the people who are on side of me, who want to see me succeed. So, if you guys enjoy what I do, and all I look at it as is genuine kindness, and I'm just really humbled that you guys would even take the time out of your day to leave a comment, and perhaps constructive criticism. So, but enough of that. I'm here to help you guys relax, get to sleep, and just spread good vibes. And like I always say, I don't want any negativity from me on my channel. So, yeah, I just hope you guys have a great night. You sleep well. Then you wake up feeling, as my morning jacket would say, good and limber. Have a great night and an even better day tomorrow, guys. See you next time.